Good morning, everyone, and welcome back. Welcome home to everyone here. Welcome home to St. Andrews and those of you at home and online. Welcome home to all of you and to all of us. I have a couple of announcements for you, so settle in, get ready, and your order of service has them as well. But first of all, I want to remind you that we're in June. Hard to believe, it's June 2nd, and June is two things. It's Indigenous History Month, and it is also the month for Pride. So over today and the next few weeks, we're going to touch on those things through our time. We'll be woven into our time of worship. Also, next Sunday is the 9th, and we will be looking at the United Church of Canada's history and who we are as part of all this, because it's the United Church of Canada's 99th anniversary the next day. And so it starts the year of the 100th, which we'll prepare for next year for the 100th anniversary. But we'll look at that next week, which will lead us into June 16th. And on that day, what we are going to be doing is doing the moccasin symbol somewhere outside so that we can honor our Indigenous heritage in the land on which we actually join. So on the 16th, don't come dressy clothes. Wear something grubby because we'll go outside. Who knows, you might be painting or something for a couple of minutes. And let's see, what else did I have? A reminder in your order service, always take a good look in the afternoon. But Brenda and I have put in a message for you, similar to what we had put in like March 10th after our congregational meeting. So first, it is a thank you for the support that you all offer this church in so many ways. And the second part is, you may have noticed, I think, we have an issue up there in the ceiling, and there was a number of days where there was white bits all over the floor. That would be that going there. And the reason for it is roof leaks. So our roof has lost shingles and it's caused us to have some leaks. Now, hold on to your, I was going to say chair, pew, whatever. The estimate so far is looking at $26,000 to $30,000 to repair the bits of places on the roof. So that's in addition to our already forecasted deficit of around about $45,000. That feels like a big number, doesn't it? So let's try and break it apart. First of all, we do have reserves. We need to be really wise with our reserves, right? And the second thing is that last year you had a deficit of approximately the 45, and you reduced it to 13,000 by the end of the year. So we know lots of good stuff's possible. After the congregational meeting, what we put in the order of service was to consider, what if 100 or so givers gave up a coffee a week, what's that, $2 to $4, right, if you go for a coffee? And we estimated that 52 weeks, 100 givers giving up a coffee and giving the coffee money to the church, it would be about $20,800. That's pretty much half the deficit, or pretty much paying for the roof. So bringing it down to little bits, but together we can see how we can do something pretty good. And so something for you to think about in terms of your own life and what you might be able to do to help, to pay for the roof, and to just keep ourselves being in a healthy financial situation. And also, just a quick reminder, Louise has said to remind everyone the UCW luncheon is next Monday. You will be getting an email, and the email will give you details about the lunch as well. I think that was it. Is that it, Louise? And I'm going to invite Brenda to come and talk to you. Brenda has something really important as well. This is important day. So we'll let Brenda talk.
When I have to figure out where to stand here, I'm wearing shoes I haven't worn for a while. Now everyone's going to look at them. Don't look at them. And I wobble. Anyway, just a bit of an update. You might have seen the notice in the newsletter and in the order when the order of service came out about some recent banking activities, and you might be concerned. No cause for concern. We have caught the problem early, very early, and with absolutely minimal effect to the church. Passwords and everything have been changed. We're all good going forward. But I just wanted to let you know that if any email says to put in a password or something for the church bank account, don't. It's not a good email to follow. And this might also be a good time to kind of look at our own personal security and change passwords and things like that. And also, if you happen to get an email that you look at and you think, that kind of sets little things, you know, spidey senses, trust your senses and either check and see who the email is really from or don't open it. Call someone and ask for reassurance that it is valid or it's not. Okay? Any questions, please come and see me after the service, but again, there is no cause for concern. Thanks.
Just adding to that, we all know what happened with that piano we were supposed to get. We forgot to tell Alicia. She just asked about the piano. And it's like, oh yeah, that was a scam. We got to watch out for the scams. And I'd like to know, I was saying to Brenda, is anyone in the church named Molly? Did Molly email me at the church with this idea? And I don't think it's you. I don't think any of you are Molly. So there's just be really careful, as Brenda said, because there's all sorts of strange things out there, right? Anyhow, on that note, let's quiet our thoughts. Let's open our hearts to God beyond us, around us, among us, within us. Let's open our hearts to each other here and beyond here. Let's just open our hearts to love and to contemplate these words from 1 Samuel. Samuel, who was a young boy, was lying down in the temple of the Lord. And then the Lord called, Samuel, Samuel. Think of the Lord calling your name. And ask Michelle to come and offer us her acknowledgement for justice, and then we'll be lighting the Christ candle.
Good morning. We acknowledge injustices inflicted on those who come from many ethnicities, faiths, and societies. Hate has no place in Jesus' teaching, nor should it live within us. We strive to open our hearts and minds and embrace differences. In doing so, we will be examples of the acceptance and love Jesus had for everyone.
By the light of day and by the dark of night, we are never alone. God in Christ is with us always. So we light this candle here today as a symbol of Christ's presence, love's presence with us always. Let's remain seated as we offer our introit as our own prayers to God.
Spirit of the Lord.
The ancient psalmist prayed to God, and the psalmist said, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You search out my path and my lying down. Where can I go from your spirit? Even in the darkness and the night, it's not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is light to you. For all of us today, in the dark, as we sit in like an evening time, in the silence of the dawn, or in the brightness of the day, or even in the calm of dusk, let us know that God calls us, even as God has called us into this place together, this morning and this day.
Pray.
Holy God, through each night and into every dawn, every new dawn, you are with us, and you call to us, inviting us to hear, to listen, to answer, to follow. And it is in following that we love and we serve. May we hear your still small voice today, speaking to our hearts, enlivening our minds, refreshing our souls with and within your indwelling presence. May we answer with the words of the ancients, Here I am, Lord. By the Spirit's power may we answer. May we follow with and within the Christ of our faith. Amen. Don't need to tell you that our world is so busy and so loud and all the time, and it is bright and it is chaotic, and there's tons to worry about, even at night. It's a wonder we can even hear ourselves think, let alone hear God's still small voice, or God's whisper to our hearts. So let's pray for us to understand the need to pause and to rest and to really be silent and to know peace. Let us pray. God of the day and God of the night, in every moment within and beyond our comprehension, you are there. Yet our world is loud and bright and busy. Our world is filled with tasks and expectations and opinions and laws and deadlines and concerns. But sometimes we just don't or can't or we won't just stop and pause and rest in the silence. That we might feel the peace of your presence or even just listen to your guidance. So we do so now, God. Guide us now in this time and place. To know and to practice the Sabbath space, the holy time, a full night, a full day, that we might be present with you. Amen. Let us be assured that as the voices of the past have told us, God was made known in a cloud, or God was made known like in a pillar of fire, or in a burning bush, or in the breath that went over chaos that created the land over the waters. God was and is always heard as the voice that speaks out to our ears not to our ears, to our hearts. May our hearts listen. Amen. Some time with the kids and for us all to be kids at heart. You ready, guys? How are you doing? Good? You guys doing good? Yep, that's good. God is good? All the time? God is good. So in the Hebrew scriptures, that's the Jewish scriptures that we read because Jesus was Jewish and we learn from him and his story too. There's a part that talks about, or a story that talks about Moses. And Moses goes up on a mountain, and there Moses meets God, or God's presence, and he gets what's called, we call the Ten Commandments, which are 10 things you should and shouldn't do. And the first few are about how you are in relationship to God, and the rest are how we should be in relationship to each other, how we should treat each other. But in that first bunch, well, they're called the Decalogue, too, meaning the 10 words, sort of God's 10 words, the Decalogue. In there, there's one of them that says, honor the Sabbath. Well, first of all, you'd have to know what a Sabbath was, wouldn't you, in order to honor it and respect it. So in Hebrew, Sabbath, or it actually is Shabbat, it means rest. Just rest and peace and let everything go. Just have rest. Like no computers, like no TV, like no work. That was the main thing, is rest your bodies. And that was part of this thing to Moses. Tell all the people that one thing they got to do is take a day of rest, okay? And a day is considered from sundown all the way through the next day to sundown again. We tend to think it's morning to morning. That's not the way it's written in the scriptures. So anyhow, this is something that was a rule back then, is that you had to take a day of rest and no working on the day of rest. There's real wisdom in that too. So, in the New Testament, which is about Jesus and the church, we come across a story where Jesus is trucking along with his disciples. They're going through a field of wheat, of grain, right? Guess what happens? They're hungry, so they want to get some food. So they take a look. Here's an example. It's not real. Now it's going to get stuck in the box. This is sort of what they found. And what they were looking to do is take these pieces and break them apart to get the seeds out so they could eat them, to get the wheat, the grains. And there was a bigger problem, though, besides the work of getting this to get food. It was the Sabbath. So the day they were supposed to be resting. And on the one hand, they were hungry and they knew it was the Sabbath. What are you supposed to do, right? Well, some Pharisees who were sort of like, they were like the keepers of the law, the oral law, right? That said, don't work on Sundays or don't work on the Sabbath. They went up to Jesus and said, what's this? Your people are eating, they're doing stuff, they're working, taking all these out to work on the Sabbath. You know what Jesus said? He said, even King David, the great King David of their own history, he even knew that his people needed to eat and take food for themselves on the Sabbath. Therefore, his people weren't doing anything wrong either. So I thought that was pretty important because in our world today, there is no day that everybody just stops working. There's all sorts of places, and there always has been places. Hospitals don't close on a Sunday, do they? Right? Or let's see, what else? Do policemen say, oh, so sorry, it's now Saturday night. I don't work anymore till Monday. That doesn't happen. So it's always been that some people have had to work on what we call our Sabbath. But at some point during the week, you have to take a rest. Now, years ago, when I was in school, I was studying courses on the brain, you know, in here. And it was brain mechanisms and the behaviors and how our brain works. I learned something really cool from one professor, one doctor. And he said, how many hours in a day are there? 24, right? And he said, when you're really little, you tend to need lots of sleep. Maybe kids can sleep like 9 hours, maybe 10 if parents are lucky, right? Then when you get really older, you might be up several times in the night, maybe only sleeping 5 hours at a time, right? On the average, did you work out? Yeah, me too. Did you see the sunrise too? Yeah. Well, over your whole lifetime, it averages out, you need about 8 hours sleep a night. That's one third of your day. You're supposed to be resting and asleep, right? And what he said is, think of your whole life then. One third of your life, you need to be asleep. So sleep must be very important to our bodies if we need to be asleep a third of our lives. That's pretty amazing, right? And you can sleep best when you've also learned how to rest and bring yourself to rest. So the Sabbath is a really important thing. But so is eating and making sure that everybody has food all the time. So let's put our hands together and we'll say, Dear Jesus, help me to be honest. Help me to be kind. Help me to be loved. Amen. And hear us as we say the words Jesus taught the first disciples. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. So you guys go to Sunday school, joyful noise, and yeah, I don't think you're resting today, but have fun. So we have one scripture reading today. I've already given you lots of hints of what it is. But it's 1 Samuel chapter 3, 1 to 10. Now the book we call 1 Samuel, this is like a no-brainer, it goes hand in hand with 2 Samuel, right? 1st and 2nd. What we don't always realize is that what follows is 1st and 2nd Kings. And in the history makeup of the Bible, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings were all like one big thing. Okay? So the books go together, and together they tell the story of Israel's rise to having a monarchy and then what happened with the monarchy. It begins today with the story of God calling to a young boy, Samuel, or Shamuel. He was born to, and this is common in scripture, if someone is born to a barren woman late in life, that child is important. So he is born to a barren woman late in life, and her name is Hannah. Hannah's son Shamuel was then known as a gift from God, for which she had prayed, and he had answered her prayers. So she lent him back to the Lord to live with Eli, Eli is a priest. He's a priest of the Lord. So together Samuel or Shemuel is with Eli in the temple of the Lord that he might serve the Lord or serve God. As we hear this portion of a big story, let's listen for the images and the words of dark and light, word and vision, call and answer, lying down to sleep, rising up to respond, and of silence and of voice. And Louise is going to offer us the story.
Good morning. Am I on? Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
May God's blessing be upon the words sung and spoken and heard and offered and prayed this day. Last week, I was approached by a young woman. She's in her 30s, and she is considering ministry. You don't know her. She's from somewhere else. She's been raised in the Anglican Lutheran tradition her whole life. But because of her beliefs around acceptance and social justice and sexuality, she is considering leaving her tradition to join the United Church. I know her mom and dad from way, way, way back, you know, like the 80s, right? Her dad suggested she reach out to me, and this young woman, like we spoke the other night for 2 hours. She's questioning not just where to go to study, not just what it's like in ministry or the United Church. She's questioning, how does she know it's God calling her to do any of it? So we talked about what she feels called to. Is it scripture? Tradition? Is it pastoral care? Preaching? Social justice, I think, is a big one. But what is it she feels so passionate about she just can't let it go? You know what? You would love to meet her. She is so filled with a loving compassion and desire and a longing to work with people, to build communities, to help and serve others, and she has other experience in the secular world doing so. But, as I said to her, the questions she is likely to be asked at any candidacy interview are these. What is your call report? How have you heard God speak to you? Why not teaching? Why not social work? Why not nursing? Why ministry, especially in the time of decline in the churches in Canada and the Western world? So she said to me that she didn't know what I was talking about, that she didn't know what a call report was. She'd never heard it before. So I sent her to read the prophets. I sent her there because that is where I learned of the pattern of God's presence in the world. It was from a professor, this amazing professor I had back in 2000 or 1999. I didn't know to even know how to appreciate who I was working with. And I didn't know that he actually studied with a major theologian prominent in the 50s and 60s. I hadn't a clue who these two guys were. I just went to class, right? But he kind of like really opened up to the scriptures to me to show me how special words and patterns are in stories, book after book, in Hebrew, in repetition and origins of rituals and practices. He said it's like pulling a thread through the scriptures and all these things come together. It was really fascinating being with him. He said it's like, think of the formula. Whenever there is 3 days mentioned in scripture, pay attention, because the third day is a biggie. The third day is God's intervention over and over, as it was in Samuel, the Samuel story today. And as we've said before, seven, when you see a pattern or seven has come up, or multiples of seven, it means completion or Sabbath or rest or divinity as in perfection and completion. And then he also said there is a threefold pattern that he referred to as God's call and what happens with God's call. And he said from the beginning of creation and the word through the scriptures, as the word is heard, there is a pattern, and a pattern begins with the call or the word. And there are many persons in the biblical stories who have heard the word and who have a call report. So from the first creation myth, it's the call, it's God's words and breath that create the land out of the chaos, the waters of chaos. Just as, think of the Jesus story, Jesus calling out over the tumult of the storm to the frightened disciples in the boat to calm the waters. That's the power of the word that the scripture writers are telling us. It's the power of God's word, however you understand it, with breath, to create and to calm and to make, right? But it is also from Moses to Jesus and more that we learn of God calling to human hearts. We hear it in our mind's ear, not our ear, or we see a vision or we have a dream and we hear somehow special words maybe in the dream that mean something desperately real to us. That's how it happened for me, and I'll tell you another day. But the prophets hear God. They hear the word of the Lord. That's what they say in the beginning of each of the writings, their books. The other thing is they respond. They answer and they respond to God. And often their words are, and it's in Hebrew, it's like Hineni Adonai, it's here I am, Lord, fully present to you. So the call of the word of the Lord came to you. Are you ready? Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Joshua, Deborah, Gideon, Job, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Jonah, Micah, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, Mary, Joseph, and of course Samuel, right? That's pretty much all the prophets. We need to look at Samuel. Why him? Why this young boy, right? Because we make an assumption that God calls to adults. God has no problem with different ages. So let's understand Eli. Eli is an old priest, and he is basically blind. He's old, he's blind. And you know what? He has two very wicked, wretched sons. And in that time in the world, they would be taking over. It says God's word was rare. That means people weren't listening. It wasn't being heard, both obviously the wretched, wicked sons of Eli. Imagine him being the priest and having his awful sons. But anyway, but the Israelites weren't listening either. The scripture says it was night, like everyone is settled. It's quiet. And it says the lamp of God had not yet gone out. Well, the lamp of God could have not gone out, might have meant that it wasn't morning yet because the oil had not gone out in the lamp of God in the temple, right? So they'd had a light. But it could also mean that the lamp of God in Eli had not gone out, that Eli still, even blind and old, he still knew how to hear and understand God's call. So God calls to the boy Samuel, or Shamuel, three times, right? Uh-oh, three, that's big. He calls to him three times, and Eli tells him what's happening and how to answer. Now, this is all happening. Samuel was called during a time that was spiritual desolation in the people. There was also religious corruption. Take a look at the sons of Eli. There was political danger, immorality, and spiritual upheaval, and the question was, who is going to lead the people? Not those two guys, right? To all the prophets, there is this call. The God calls pattern. God calls, gathers together, and upholds them through a mission. They have a task. They have a purpose. God sends them to get it done. And even if they resist, like Jonah, he resisted big time. Well, eventually he said okay. Samuel would be called. Samuel is given a mission. And it is Samuel that, get this, would go to Bethlehem. And in Bethlehem, Samuel would be a part of the anointing of one of Jesse's sons, whose name would be David, you know, in the city of David. And he would be the one who would be anointed king, who would lead the people and bring an end to Saul's reign and create a new wondrous reign under King David. So Samuel, with this role he had to play, he was to bring the word of the Lord to the Israelites as a prophet, as a priest, and as you read the story, basically as a military leader too. Weird combination maybe, but that's what it was. And he brought an end to the time of the judges and brought about the beginning of the era of the kings. Often in scripture, when you hear someone that hears the word of the Lord, they answer with Hineni Adonai, or here I am, Lord. Abraham said it, Isaac said it, Mary said it, Samuel said it, and we're going to say it too. We sing it. You've already got the song in your head, right? Here I am, Lord. We're going to sing it. But really listen to the words you're singing, every word. Know what you're saying from the depth of your heart when you say, here I am, Lord, because you are answering as Samuel did and all the other prophets. The Bible also tells us that the incarnate Jesus called to. Jesus called to the fishermen, come and follow, gathering them together, upholding them through his teaching, his life, his death and resurrection, sending them out with the Holy Spirit. That pattern is just as God had done so with the Israelites, leading them into and out of the wilderness, where they would learn there and then grow in faith and be sent to the promised land. So there was the call to Moses. People were gathered, upheld, they were sent. But God did the same thing with the Jews in Babylon too. There was calls to Ezra and Nehemiah, but there was the calls to them. The people were in Babylon, in exile there. That's where they learned. They were upheld and learned that they could hear and sing the song of Zion in a strange land. They learned God is still with them out there too. And then it was God's agent, Cyrus the Persian king, who sent them back, go back to Jerusalem, rebuild the temple, rebuild the city, and make it a new promised land. And you know what? We're called all the time in Christ too. We are called to gather and to be upheld with one another and to be sent. When I first learned about this pattern from that really wise professor, I got to tell you, I was amazed. I had no idea the scripture had such depth and patterns and all this kind of stuff. And it was a systematic theology course, which was scary enough. But we were all amazed in that class. And then we started searching the scriptures to see, is that pattern, is it in many other places? Where do we see it? And then one day, sitting outside the lecture hall on the floor with our pop or whatever, like a bunch of teenagers, you figure these, you know, 40, 50, 60-year-olds sitting on the floor. And we were sitting there like teenagers in high school, but we started to share our own stories. Gathered there on the floor, sharing our stories, hearing how we felt that we had been gathered somehow in that place. The more we talked about it, we called it the Gus Factor. The Gus Factor of God's presence, that God calls, we have a choice to answer or not. When we do answer, we are gathered together, upheld, and we're sent out with whatever new task to do. So we called it being gussed. We would ask each other even days later, when were you gussed? What was it like to be gussed? How were you gussed? With whom were you gussed? We began to really share our stories. It was courageous. It was intimate sharing of our experiences of God. We shared how we were gussed. What we were sharing was our very personal call reports of God calling to us and what it was like and how it happened. This is what that young woman is going to have to explain or share. She'll likely have to answer when she goes before any sort of candidacy committee for ministry. It's not just for the prophets. It's not like the prophets like Samuel, young or old, or the Israelites or the Jews. It's not just the early disciples. Because we're all called. Somewhere, sometime, somehow, we're all called to be somewhere or be with others, like being here right now. That's why we have a call to worship. That's the other part of the call, right? But we're here, we're called, we're supported, we're upheld here by God's presence through and with each other, by God's word, by our song, our words sung and spoken, woven together. And then we are sent out at the end of every service. We are commissioned to the world with a purpose, right? A purpose to love and serve. Just as Moses was and Samuel was, the disciples were, the other prophets. And the disciples, yeah, that's us too, right? We're disciples. Even in our own lives, as I experienced with the other MDiv students, God's action can be seen if we think about it. Think about in your life when there's been a trial or a challenge, maybe an illness, maybe a death, maybe it's grief, maybe it was loss of work, maybe it was family upset. Did you find you were somehow gathered and upheld and supported? And maybe you learned through that time. I bet each of you could think of a time when you've had just the right people in your life at just the right place with just the right knowledge or skills. Or maybe, as in my case, it was mysteriously a stranger in my life that had all of those things at just the right time that I needed a certain experience to be shared with me. When it happened in your life, how did they support you? Or was it you supporting them? Or was it someone else? And then, what did you learn through an experience of supporting and helping others? What did you learn from that experience? Or what did you learn that then you applied, or you found yourself knowing or sharing, helping someone else, gathered in a new situation with someone new? So it's gathered, upheld, and sent. That's Gus. We called it the Gus factor of God's eternal presence and action in the world, how God is creatively and redemptively working in our world, working in the lives of all people to bring healing and mending and reconciliation and wholeness and peace out of every time of wilderness, exile, cave, struggle, change, or challenge. One Gus factor experience at a time, he said. One person, one group, one people, or one church family like us, like you. Gathered, upheld, taught, supported through something by the power of the Holy Spirit. So maybe it was through change, and we're all dealing with a lot of change. But God is with us. What about through COVID? That was a time, right? Through transition? That was difficult, but you were upheld. But in every case, it's preparing us for something new, with word and vision and hopes and dreams. It's for the future here, how we will serve in Markham. And then with all of that support and learning and growing, you have a mission, you have a purpose, and you're sent to make it so. It might take time, it might still take some challenges to be overcome, but you're together, and so you do it together and you face it together. I really do believe you were guest here, whether you know it or not, you were guest beyond Sunday mornings. I also believe, given what was happening in my life, I believe I was guest to come here, and you were a part of upholding me and helping me when I came here. With whom else are you or are we being guest? And what is it that is our new mission or purpose? What's our next step? What are we to do? Who are we to invite and welcome? I hope that in this next few weeks, we might take the time to share with each other when we feel we've been gussed and talk about it, how we see ourselves maybe being gussed right now. And you know what? Like us sitting on the floor back at the seminary, even in sharing your stories of your lives, you're being gussed because you've gathered and you're starting to share and support each other in the sharing of the stories. You're upholding each other. So called and gathered to share, upheld and upholding through the telling and the retelling, revealing even. You've been sent out to live the gift of the revelation of what you've experienced and heard and learned, and by the power of the Spirit that changes us deeply inside. Again, we called it the Gus factor, God's pattern in the world, God's pattern within us all. This is what that young woman will need to answer before she can go into ministry, or likely so. When have you felt God's presence, they will ask her. When have you felt God's absence? What happened? What did you learn? And what is your call report? Describe God's words or word to your heart. Having spent that time with her, and a few years ago as well, when she first started on this journey, I believe she's finding her answer. And I believe it will lead her to say with Samuel, "Here I am, Lord. It is I, Lord." And maybe she will even say, "I heard you calling in the night, in the silence of the night." Because you know what? That's where God's still small voice really can be heard. Often it really is in the time of rest and peace and silence. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I have heard my people cry.
SBC. Before we begin our prayers of the people, I wanted to tell you that I received a message this morning. Actually, it was sent yesterday, but I wasn't online, so I didn't get it till this morning. It's from a friend far to the east who has a friend in Whitby. And at the home of that friend, they were having a private family pride celebration. Unfortunately, protesters came. Don't know the ins and outs of the story, but the call put out yesterday that I did not get was if anyone was around, could they please go to the home and just stand with the family who were having a private family pride celebration. I didn't get the call, but it was a call, right? And anyhow, they've asked for prayers for the family and for all those who are trying to just celebrate the journey of being LGBTQ+, but gays and lesbians, the journey they've been on since the 70s to just be accepted and loved and have equal rights. That was the request. I didn't get it till this morning. Let us pray. Calling God to our hearts, not our ears, and yet sometimes our ears pick it up. God, you call to our minds, not our eyes, but sometimes our eyes do see what is happening. God, you call in the dark, silent night, and sometimes it's in the bright, sun-kissed day. But when we pause, God, then we are made aware, we can be made aware. Gathering us together as in this place, and being among us and with and within us, you uphold us even now, that we might be strong and courageous and compassionate, that we might stand with and be voice for those against whom others shun or antagonize or protest and hate. Holy God, may we learn this month about our history, about our colonial past, about the story of the First Nations people and the Inuit and Métis. May we learn of the prejudice and racism against them, and also learn about the prejudice and hatred in the story behind those who are gay and lesbian and more. And there are others, God, who are shunned or treated poorly or hated in our world. May we learn and may we grow together. We do so within the power of love. And may we come to see a call to our own hearts, a call to us collectively, a mission for us to take on a renewed purpose or adding to our purpose. May we be sent, God, into ourselves here and out there with open hearts, open hands, new understanding, and creating paths to peace and compassion and welcome and grace. God, may we hear the cries and suffering of the world, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, may we discern what we might do or say, even just from this small corner of the world here in Markham. And for all beyond us, with us, among us, who are hurting in many ways, who have been hurt, all who are ill in body, mind, or soul, all who are recovering, all who are healing, and all who pray for healing and mending, we too pray. And we pray also for reconciliation and peace and an end to all violence. God, now we hold much in our hearts. We pray you will hear us as we offer our most personal prayers that come from the depths of within us and that we offer to you in the sacred silence. Holy One, assured that you and we hear the cries of others, that you and we can listen, hear, and discern and choose to act. May we find the power of your Holy Spirit within us, and may we do so. May we speak the voice of you, the Lord. May we offer a call, may we answer the call, and may we stand up for justice always. Amen. Lisa is going to offer our invitation doctrine.
We have heard the story of God calling to Samuel, as God called to the other prophets, and as God calls and speaks to us. We are invited to follow the one who revealed God in the flesh. With every new day that unfolds, from morning to the close of the evening, let us continually, prayerfully, and graciously commit our words, our actions, our resources to living out our faith as the word that speaks to our hearts, minds, and souls.
Let us pray. Holy God of the journey, God of arrival, God of life and love, abundance and grace, we offer our gifts, those we have committed, those we've already given, those we plan to give, those we've offered through PAR, and the gifts of our time, our hands, our faith, and in all the ways we give of ourselves here, the way we give of ourselves beyond here. And together in all that we do, may they be blessings of life and love to those in need. And may we, in giving our gifts, be blessed in turn with life and love in Christ's name. May all our gifts be our response to your call to come, to gather, to uphold each other and the stranger, and then to go and serve with and within the Christ, from night to morning, from dusk to dawn, in our waking, in our sleeping, as each day comes and as each day is done. Amen. Our closing hymn is normally one that would be used in an evening service, but as this day we've been talking about Samuel in the night, I thought, what the heck, let's do a nighttime song in the morning of the day. You don't sing it usually because it's not nighttime. We are called and we're gathered here. We've been upheld now through word and song and the life and the love among us all. Now we are sent to the world. We are commissioned with the word to go. We're gathered, upheld, sent. We're being sent. So let's go. And may we see the Christ in the faces of all whom we meet. But may all whom we meet see the face of Christ in us too. Amen.
Oh, now in peace, never be alone.
the love of God surround you. May that peace of Christ dwell deep within you, and that compassion of the Holy Spirit, may it flow to and through you as you are now sent to the world. Amen. While Alicia plays on our piano, not the big one we thought we were getting, let's all come forward and we will wave to those at home.